On behalf of everyone on the panel, I'd like to thank Jacob for that excellent introduction, a little tour around the world. And clearly, we are in an environment now in which the state of the global economy is really foremost in the minds of so many because it affects so much. And one of the things that really has been striking to me has been the following recognition. My own training is in economics and mathematics and computer science. And for the last few decades, the practice of economics has been very much driven by math and by models. And you can do that when you're looking only at small changes and you're trying to quantify them and trying to forecast the next small change. But that's not where we are now, and it's not where we have been for the last handful of years. And it reminds me that before the Second World War, economics was always referred to as political economy, with a recognition that it was government policy and developments within a population that really drove economic growth. And when I talk about economic growth, it's not as sterile a measure as gross domestic product or industrial production. When I refer to economic growth, I'm also talking about the standard of living for workers and the creation of wealth for the population. And we need to recognize that in this period, which is one of enormous disruption and enormous structural change, we cannot rely on the simple models, the simple calculus of a small change here leading to a small change someplace else, but really to talk about the broader picture. And so from that standpoint, it probably is a very good idea to talk about the United States. We represent in the United States economy an area of relative stability. Not stability, but relative stability. Our economy is not in recession. Our economy is growing at about 2% per annum after adjustment for inflation. And when we compare this to other major industrial economies, specifically those in Europe, this looks like something of an oasis. But as Jacob indicated, we do have problems with which we must deal. Some of these are short-term, and some of these are long-term. And before I answer specifically the question as to whether we have run out of ammunition to deal with our problems, let me describe the current state of play in the United States. As I mentioned, economic growth running about 2% with significant variation by quarter. Depends upon the weather, it depends upon inventory buildup and other factors. But when we look at what has happened to our economy since the worst portion of the Great Recession, what we do see is recovery almost everywhere. And so, for example, our single fastest growing sector over the last 3 years, our recession ended in the summer of 2009. And over that period of time, spending, specifically investment in business equipment, software, computer applications, is up 45%. This is not the sign of an economy which is stuck in the doldrums. In addition, we have seen very significant growth in our exports. Since summer 2009, exports from the United States are up 35%. Now, I have to point out that the United States is a very significant exporter. Many people often forget that. We are the world's largest importer. We do have a large trade deficit, but we are also a huge exporter. And what we export tends to be high value-added goods and services. Very simply, think about Apple computers, think about iTunes, think about entertainment and media, exports, and so on. And what we know is that there is demand for these products, and it's not very sensitive to currency, and it very often moves in a less volatile fashion than the rest of the economy. We've also seen growth since the end of the recession in terms of consumer spending. That's up 15% approximately over the last 3 years. There is one sector of our economy that is still declining, and that is the government sector. Government spending is actually down about 5%. And here we get to the question of political economy, decisions being made at the governmental level about the appropriate next steps. In an economy which Jacob points out has an unemployment rate of 8.2%, it's a little bit unusual to see government spending being reduced and being reduced this sharply. And part of the explanation is the federal nature of our political system. We have a national government which provided a good deal of stimulus. Many people think not enough, but provided a good deal of stimulus at the worst point of the credit crisis. But our state and local governments over the last year or two find themselves in their own budget crises because unlike the federal government, which can run deficits year after year, most state and local governments must balance their budgets each and every year. And what we see is that there are significant spending cuts at the state and local level, and this is indeed causing a drag on the U.S. economy. Our GDP growth would be perhaps 0.5 percentage point higher than it currently is, and very importantly, our unemployment rate would be much lower. The average, instead of being 8.2%, would be 7.2%, if not for the firings by state and local governments of employees, including teachers and policemen and firemen. Jacob made some comment about the wide gap in employment in the United States by education. And I had the opportunity last year at this conference to give a very lengthy lecture on this subject. Let me give you just some of the high points. Our aggregate unemployment rate, as we've already heard, 8.2%. But for those people who have a university education, the unemployment rate is under 4%. For those who have a high school education or less, the unemployment rate is approximately 15%. The other thing we, of course, see is a wide variation in income distribution in the United States, which is highly correlated to these differences in education. Something we need to understand is that these disparities began to develop not as a consequence of the financial crisis, but well before. About 10 years before the credit crisis, we began to see these gaps emerge in a more dramatic fashion, and they began to widen. And one of the problems had been that young men in the United States about 10 years ago said the opportunity cost of going to continue their education was too high. So instead of spending money for tuition and spending the time to get a college degree, many of them went to work in the construction industry, where at least the hourly compensation seemed quite high. This has proven to be a short-term, perhaps a benefit, long-term, a very big mistake. And so one of the issues that we're now facing in the United States is how to address this disparity in education, in which we see that many people at the median income level and below have not been continuing their education, and people in the higher categories have been. I had the opportunity of giving a lengthy lecture last week at Technion, which has engaged in a partnership with Cornell University, where I have served on the board for many years. And there is enormous enthusiasm at both institutions of higher learning about what can be done. The importance of basic research, the importance of translating that basic research in so many categories of technology. Some of it is IT, some of it is medical, some of it is climate-related and architecture-related, and turning that into new jobs. And I guess, Jacob, with regard to that, I am an optimist that things, in fact, can be done. Before I turn the microphone over to others on this panel, I'd like to touch very briefly on China. The United States, not China, is the world's largest economy, and by a very substantial margin. China, even after the phenomenal growth over the last decade, has a GDP just about 40% the size of the United States. And while China was growing very rapidly, it is now showing deceleration in growth. One of the arguments was that who needed the large developed economies anymore? There was more than enough economic vigor and economic energy elsewhere in the world. And I would say that there are now two questions related to China. Specifically, number one, so much of Chinese growth was linked not to domestic demand, but to exports. So question number one, from a political economy standpoint, is what will and what can China do to bolster its own domestic demand, to keep its economy growing, and to keep the standard of living in that country from declining and hopefully to continue to rise? And the second open-ended question, which I hope we'll have as a panel an opportunity to discuss, is this. We all know about the financial crisis. We hear about it every morning. We hear about it every evening in terms of the developments or lack of developments in Europe. The meetings in Los Cabos, Mexico this week, the meetings in Europe last week, how to approach the Eurozone, should it be restructured, what should happen to the banking systems, and so on. And I find it fascinating that we rarely talk about the role that China might play in this area. Keep in mind that much of the growth in China and some other emerging economies has been linked to strong exports to the developed world, including to Europe. And over the period of this financial crisis, China has rightfully moved ahead in terms of its participation in the multinational order. No longer the G7 or the G8, the G20, and discussions at the World Bank and the IMF, including China. And what we need to see is a movement forward in terms of not just being given the place at the table, but also an opportunity to come forward with some suggestions for responsible solutions.